Thank you for watching this video from Kingsway Soft. Today, I will be introducing the SSIS Integration Toolkit for NetSuite. The NetSuite Toolkit is a high-performance data integration solution that works for NetSuite utilizing Microsoft's SQL Server Integration Services capabilities. In today's demo, we will show you our software running in a SQL Server 2012 environment. If you are using a different SQL Server version, the interface will be slightly different. To get started, let's create a simple SSIS project. This tutorial assumes that you already have the SSIS bits installed, otherwise you will not see the SSIS project type here. In the Business Intelligence template, select the Integration Services project and give your project a name. Press OK to create the solution. SSIS is a platform that can be used to implement data migration and integration using drag and drop capabilities. To begin the SSIS implementation using our toolkit, we will create a connection to the NetSuite server. To do so, right-click in the Connection Manager area and select New Connection. Then we will choose NetSuite from the list and press Add. The Server URL field lets you specify the URL of the NetSuite instance you will connect to. There are two authentication types available, Request and Session. For the request option, each request sent to NetSuite contains authentication credentials. For the session option, the component creates a session and uses it to send requests to NetSuite, so credentials are not sent with every request. Next, you would add your login credentials for your NetSuite account, starting with email and password. The account ID specifies the ID associated with your account. For more details on how to locate your ID on the NetSuite portal, please refer to our online help manual page. Next, specify the application ID that the NetSuite components will use to interact with your NetSuite instance. To create an application ID on NetSuite, please refer to our online help manual page. You can then specify the user time zone of the user account for this connection. It is important that this property is set correctly, so that the date values read from the server can be interpreted correctly. Role ID is the ID of the role you wish to use. To use the default role, you can leave this field blank. For the Max Concurrent Requests option, NetSuite accounts typically have a limit on the number of concurrent requests allowed, and it will return an error if too many concurrent requests are sent simultaneously. The component can limit the number of concurrent requests that will be sent to prevent such errors. The timeout option lets you specify the maximum number of seconds that the connection manager will wait while trying to connect with NetSuite. This option is defaulted to 120 seconds. Let's head to the Advanced Settings tab. There is an option for retry on intermittent errors. This option is intended to help recover from possible intermittent outages or disruption of service, so that the integration does not have to be stopped due to temporary networking issues. We have designed this option so that it should only retry when it's deemed to be safe to do so, but there may be exceptions. We also have proxy server connection settings, which you can enter if you are behind a proxy server. Before we hit OK, we should test the connection to make sure our information is correct and we can connect successfully. Please note that the connection manager that we just created is a package-level connection manager. For SSIS 2012 or later, you can create project-level connection managers if you right-click the connection manager's node within the Solution Explorer. After creating the NetSuite connection manager, you would start to create data flow tasks to facilitate data integration. Within your data flow task, we offer two data flow components that would help you to implement integration solutions for NetSuite. The first component we're discussing is the NetSuite source component, which is what you use to read or retrieve data from NetSuite. Later on in this demo, we will show you the NetSuite destination component, which is what you may use to write data into NetSuite. In order to use these two components, you would want to make sure that they are available in the SSIS toolbox. If you're using SQL Server Integration Services 2012 or later, those two components should automatically show up there. If this is not the case, you can click the SSIS Toolbox button. Note that if you're using SSIS 2008 R2 or earlier, you would need to manually add these components to the SSIS Data Flow Toolbox. To use the NetSuite source component, we can simply drag this component to the design surface of the Data Flow task. Double-click to configure the component. Let's select a NetSuite Connection Manager. The Source Object dropdown lists all available searchable objects. There are three types of objects: Common, Advanced, and Custom. Common objects are any source that do not begin with the word Custom. Common objects can have lists of child objects, which will appear in the Child Objects dropdown. Search criteria can be specified for common objects in the search area. Custom objects can be identified as objects that start with the word custom. Custom objects are objects that are not built into the NetSuite, but were created by a user. For all common objects, an advanced version of the object exists. This can be accessed by checking the Advanced checkbox. Advanced objects have similar columns to the common version of the object, but not identical. Advanced objects do not have child objects. When reading from an advanced object, only the specified columns are returned, which can make responses come much faster. Searching for advanced objects is available by choosing the name of the search that is created in the NetSuite portal. For custom and advanced objects, there is a saved search option available, which can be used to filter results. Saved searches are created in the NetSuite portal and can contain more advanced logic than the searches used with common objects. When an advanced or custom source object is selected, the list of saved searches will be populated with the names of any saved searches applicable to that object found on the server. For custom objects, all searches for custom objects will be displayed, so it is important to select a saved search that applies to that custom object. In our example today, we will choose a common object, such as contact. Next, there's a drop-down list for child objects. As mentioned, some common source objects have child objects. These are properties that are lists of complex objects, and they are best displayed in a separate output. If a source object has child objects, they will appear as objects in the Child Object Combo box, and you can select any you wish to output. Each child object that is selected will create a new output for the SSIS component. Source objects support a batch size, which is the number of records that will be returned per service call. There's the default size, but you can set this to any number that your NetSuite server allows, up to 1,000. The Retrieve First Page Only option can be used to limit the number of records to return when reading from NetSuite. When this option is enabled, the number specified in the batch size will be used as the limit parameter. If you do not wish to retrieve all records for an object, there are two ways to search for data: field search and save search, as previously mentioned for custom and advanced objects. For field search, common objects each have several searchable fields that can be used to filter results. The fields can each be used once, and all of the conditions must be true for a record to be returned. Let's quickly add in a field search parameter here to demonstrate. Notice that we have a refresh component button to refresh the component to the latest NetSuite metadata. This retrieves and updates the latest metadata in each applicable field. We can now navigate to the Columns page to configure what fields we are reading from NetSuite. Here you will notice that by default, all the NetSuite fields are selected. This may not be the best practice. You should only select the fields that you need to use in the downstream pipeline components. As mentioned before, if any child objects were selected, the drop-down menu on the top of this page will have a secondary output column. When a common object is selected, the Add button will be visible on the Columns page. Clicking the Add button will launch the Add Custom Field dialog. This dialog allows additional fields to be added that correspond to custom fields on the object. Fields can be added manually or detected automatically. If the auto detect option is used, the component will retrieve the specified number of records from NetSuite and populate the grid with any custom fields found. For both the manual and auto detect options, the column name can be set to anything, but the script ID must be the same as the script ID of the field in NetSuite. Click OK to finish configuring the source component. For this demonstration, we are going to add dummy data readers for the purpose of showing you how the data flows from the source to destination components with the two outputs specified. We will now execute this data flow task. Next, we will create a new data flow task to demonstrate the NetSuite destination component. As mentioned before, the NetSuite destination component is used to write data to NetSuite. Our example today will create a contact record in NetSuite with address information using child object contact address book list. To demonstrate this capability, we will use the data spawner as our source component in order to generate some sample child objects to work with. The data spawner component is a part of the SSIS productivity pack, which is a collection of premium SSIS components to enable greater developer productivity. If multiple inputs or child objects are supplied, you will need to sort all of the inputs using the SSIS sort component. Now let's drag the NetSuite destination component and connect to the upstream data flow components. Double-click to open its editor form, and as you see on the general page, we must first select a NetSuite connection manager. The destination object field displays a list of available destination objects that allow write actions. Currently, there are four write actions supported for each end date: create, update, upsert, and delete. Next, there is an option to replace all child list items. If this option is selected, list of child items will be replaced with the new items for update and upsert actions. If this option is not selected, list of child items will append to or update the existing list of child items. You can also specify the batch size, which is the number of items the component will attempt to process per request. The input time zone property tells the component what time zone incoming dates are in. There are three options: UTC, local system time zone, and connection manager time zone. Next, there is a section of child object settings. Some common destination objects have child objects. If a destination object has child objects and you have provided a secondary input to the destination, they will appear as objects in the grid below and can be mapped to any available inputs. We'll select the child object in this area for contact address book list. Similar to the source component, the destination component also has a refresh component button to refresh the component to the latest NetSuite metadata. This retrieves and updates the latest metadata in each applicable field. Now we can navigate to the columns page where we map the columns from upstream components to the NetSuite destination fields for both the primary input and secondary input. When a common object is selected, the Add button will be visible on the Columns page. Clicking the Add button will launch the Add Custom Field dialog. This dialog allows additional fields to be added that correspond to custom fields on the object. Fields can be added manually or detected automatically. If the Auto Detect option is used, the component will retrieve the specified number of records from NetSuite and populate the grid with any custom fields found. For both manual and auto detect options, the column name can be set to anything, but the script ID must be the same as the script ID of the field in NetSuite. The last page is the error handling page, where there are three error handling mechanisms to choose from. The default option is fail on error, where the entire data flow will fail as soon as an error occurs. There is also the redirect rows to error output, where the error output will contain the failed records with extra columns called error code, error column, and error message. The ignore error option is generally not recommended as the component will stay silent for any errors that occur. There is also the enable columns for default output section, which you can use to enable or disable the additional column in the destination component's default output. The NetSuite record ID contains a newly created NetSuite records ID field value. Press OK to finish configuring this destination component. We can now execute this data float task. This concludes the demonstration of our SSIS Integration Toolkit for NetSuite. Thank you for watching this video. For any additional questions, please feel free to reach out to us.